Blackstone Audio presents The Gods Never Left Us, the long-awaited sequel to the worldwide bestseller Chariots of the Gods by Erich von Däniken. This book is read by Sean Runnette. Introduction. Letter to My Readers. Dear reader, in 1966 I wrote my first book, Chariots of the Gods. In the introduction I stated, writing this book requires courage, reading it no less so. Because its hypotheses and evidence do not fit into the laboriously constructed mosaic of established conventional wisdom, scholars will put it on the list of those books which it is advisable not to talk about. Meanwhile, 50 years have passed. My introduction from that time still stands today. The Gods Never Left Us is most definitely not a compendium of my previous works. In only very few sections do I have to cross-refer to my previous books, but only so that the reader is not left hanging. That extraterrestrials visited Earth millennia ago and influenced our forebears can be proved, but, and this is still the ultimate test of our knowledge, ETs are still at work today. And that concerns us all. Why do they do what they do? What does an extraterrestrial species gain from observing us, rather like we observe ants? What have the aliens actually wanted in the millennia to the present day? Can't they leave us in peace? And why do we make it so difficult for ourselves to accept the existence of extraterrestrials? That is what this book is about. To create the right mood for the main subject, I will start with a strange short story. The following science fiction story may demonstrate how extraterrestrials influenced humanity since their existence. Very warmly yours, Erich von Däniken. Chapter 1. The Gods Never Left Us. "Apparitions don't exist," Roger Favre growled defiantly. He refused tenaciously to accept the impossible when, quite obviously, something strange was going on. Something was no longer quite right. Was his mind playing games with him? His eyes, the first signs of Alzheimer's, were the usual complaints beginning to affect his 70-year-old body? Roger no longer felt quite sure of himself, but was unwilling to discuss it with anybody. Perhaps a bit less alcohol? Stop smoking? Or should he do what the know-it-alls were recommending? More exercise? And give himself a heart attack? Roger Favre sat in the same armchair in which he had been watching television for years. It was heavy, made of dark leather, with a slight bulge to support his neck and wide armrests on both sides. Roger smoked, skimmed through the daily paper, and waited for Madeleine to call him when dinner was ready. This is what had happened every evening since his retirement, and nothing seemed capable of shaking this routine until, well, until something was no longer quite right. Until these strange lights started appearing. Among his acquaintances, Roger was seen as an even-tempered kind of person. Some called him boring, others humorless, but all valued his knowledge of his subject. Roger had worked for decades as a geometry teacher in the town's high school. In French-speaking areas, high school teachers were called professor, monsieur le professeur. If there were questions about measurements or volume, and that happened frequently in the city of Geneva, his former students were happy to consult him. Roger had a 46-year-old son, who worked for the last 14 years as a physicist at the Conseil Européen pour la Recherche Nucléaire, CERN. This son had the same first name as his father. That is why Roger's wife called him Mon Petit Roger, My Little Roger. Roger Sr. had become a triple grandfather through Roger Jr. The family had done well, and he should have been able to enjoy his existence as a pensioner without any worries. If only there hadn't been the fluttering and intrusive lights that materialized at irregular intervals at foot level by his television armchair. Roger's wife's name was Madeleine, but he called her Didi, his term of endearment, because Madeleine, so he thought, made her sound like a maid and a servant. And every few years, Roger fell prey to some whim. Madeleine called it his obsessions. They came and went like the seasons, or the sudden urges of pregnant women for a particular food. On one occasion, he had planted 30 palm shoots in his garden in a fit of enthusiasm so that it would make him feel as if he were in the South Pacific. The unexpectedly freezing winter turned his South Pacific into Alaska. Another time he held forth that every reasonable paterfamilias had to ensure that he had a power generator in the house. He acquired a diesel engine and dug an illegal pit in the cellar, which he sealed with asphalt. When the power failed in the whole district, the police moved in. His tank was against the law, they yelled, and was polluting the groundwater. It had to be pumped out immediately. The whole house stank of diesel for weeks. Another episode worth mentioning was the one with the tunnel. He needed an escape tunnel to save himself and his loved ones below ground in the event of a disaster, Roger asserted with a deadly serious face. He dug valiantly with crowbars, pickaxes, and shovels for 12 weeks, and even employed helpers whom he remunerated generously for their silence. Then the groundwater came flooding into the cellar. Not all of a sudden, but rising, day after day. Ever since then, Didi had dismissively called the cellar Loch Ness. People thought of Roger as kind and helpful, just a bit eccentric, sometimes. And now, the business with the odd lights on the floor. Was he beginning totally to lose the plot? For 2 weeks, there had been these strange goings-on. Roger had bought the daily paper at the kiosk, drank a couple of beers in the Bar du Le Mans, and when he got home, greeted Didi in the kitchen.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.